My name is Rhetus Iddens, and I began employment at Canoochee EMC on April the 2nd, 1948.
What did you do for Canoochee, or what were some of the jobs that you did?
I started off digging holes. And they gave me a set of hole diggers that had 8-foot handles in it. So we had to dig the hole 6 foot deep. And the crew they put me on was, all we did was dug holes and set poles in them. And it was not easy. It was not real easy, but you got, after a while you learn a little bit more about hole digging. And it was not too bad. I stayed on it for three or four months, I reckon. And then the pay was 60 cents an hour. And paid once a week. And on a Friday afternoon when we came in, they would have a little brown envelope. And $24 didn't go very far, but that was the pay at that time for that crew I was on. And they finally came out and said, "We need somebody else to climb poles." And I said, "I'm looking for a promotion. Is any extra money with it?" And they said, "Yeah, we'll pay you 6 cents an hour more if you'll start climbing poles." I said, "Well, count me in then." Well, after the next few days, I kind of wish they'd have counted me out. So the first pole I climbed up, I cut out, and I had the coon down it. And it didn't leave too much of my shirt before I got to the ground. But nevertheless, we overcame that. And, it's really been enjoyable, and most of it. But
like you just said, it was enjoyable. Canoochee was a good job. I mean,
well, Canoochee was not a good job at that time. You tell it like it is. Canoochee was not a good job at that time. And I really particularly wanted to work at Canoochee, but I was needing a job, and me and a friend of mine, we piled around together. He said, "They're hiring out there at Canoochee now," and this was 1948. And he said, "Let's go and put in for a job." And I said, "Man, I could have got a job out there 2 or 3 months ago if I'd have wanted one. I didn't want a job out there." And he said, "Oh, come on," he said, "let's go and see if we can get a job." So we did, and of course, we both had military service. We hadn't been out too often long. But we went in, the manager then was Mr. W.L. Ritchie. And we went in, Mr. Ritchie said, "Yes," said, we hiring somebody," and said, looked at me and said, "Do you have any experience?" And I said, "No, sir, I don't know a thing about it. But I probably could learn." And looked at my buddy, and he said, "What do you know about it?" His name was Martin, Jack Martin. And he said, "Mr. Martin, what do you know about it?" He said, "Oh," he said, "I know all there are about that now." And he said, "You do?" Yeah. He said, "Where did you get some experience, Mr. Martin?" Mr. Martin said, "Well," he said, "I was in the Signal Corps, Army Signal Corps." Well, he didn't know that Mr. Ritchie was a former post utilities manager at Fort Stewart during the war. So he was in charge of all the telephone and the electrical installations and all, So he knew what he was talking about. And he knew that when you were in the Signal Corps in the Army, all you did was just string a little wire, roll it out on the ground. But he laughed about it. And he said, "You be back down here at 7:30. Now, don't be late in the morning. Tomorrow morning, you start to work." He said, "Mr. Martin, I don't think we can use you. You're overqualified. So you need to come back." I had a big joke on him with that. I had a laugh on him. But I said, "Yeah, that man knowed you were lying. He know you ain't, you ain't never seen a wire." But
What do you miss about Canoochee, or being away from Canoochee, or some people?
the people. I've always been a people person. I like to be around people. I like to meet different people. I always looked at strangers as a friend that I just had never met. And it was real interesting to me to learn new people and new names. And I've always had a knack for remembering names, and I was very good at that. After I worked on the line crew for a while, I did master the art of climbing poles, and I got where I was fairly good at it. But the best pole climber that Canucci ever had was a fellow, I think he's gonna, right there, he's following me, McKinley Brown. That's the best pole climber I ever seen. He was worse than squirrel, man. He was good. Now, he was solid good. He was a lot better than I was. But we did a lot of pole climbing. Mr. Ritchie was a kind of a unique person. In fact, I worked under three different managers, and first one was W.L. Ritchie, and the second one was Walter McCart. He came to Canucci in 1963. And then in 1985, Donald Kennedy, we just had here, he replaced Walter McCart as a general manager. And over the years, I was promoted several times over the years, and I was given the responsibility one time of conducting a survey of how many people we had in Canucci with white or different race, you know. And this was done for NRACA purposes. They wanted to know because of the funding that we were trying to get. And I did that, and it gave me exposure to a lot of people. And after that, I was given the responsibility of setting up the first meter reading routes. In the early days, we didn't read meters. The customer read their own meter. And sometimes they did, and sometimes they didn't. And most of the time they didn't. But anyway, they were supposed to read their own meters. We were supposed to spot check them ever so often. And by that time, I had been transferred to a service truck off from the line crew. And I had that responsibility of setting up the first meter route. That also gave me the opportunity to learn a lot of names and locations. I'd also did a lot of work on the mapping system. And so I had a very good knowledge of where all the lines, we not only build all of it, seems like I'm kind of repeating myself, but let me go back for just a moment. When I started at Canucci, and that was 1948, they had less than 1,000 customers. Now I'm not sure how many. I think it was around 800. Well, the way it had been set up in the beginning was they did it by projects. Now, A project, B project, C project, D project, and E project. Five different projects, and it consisted of different parts of the Canucci's territory. A project consisted primarily of the north side of Glenville and Mendez and on up into Reedsville. B project was what they had built in Bryan County. And C project was around Collins and Cobbtown. And D project was Manassas and Undine Community and north of Claxton, D project. And E project was south of Glenville and on down to Ludowice and a few people in Liberty County. But at the same time that we were on construction, they had two crews that didn't do anything but dig holes and set poles. And then they had another crew that came along and started framing the poles. They found out it was easier to do some of the hole drilling and all that, putting the hardware on it on the ground than it was to climb up a green pole and do it, you know. And we didn't have drills. It was all done with a bracing bit, and it was manual labor, you know. When we finished the projects, we were working at that we were working on, they let a contract, the first project might be interesting. First project around Glenville, it was contracted out to two of the local individuals, Gary Adamson from Glenville, he was the money man in it, and Coy Bruton from Claxton, and he was supposed to have the electrical degree, the know-how. And of course they had a contract to build all of them. A project, so many customers, so many miles of line. And they did two of those projects. And you had to build it, and they had to finance somebody to finance it, then Rural Electrification Administration would reimburse you them for building the line. And so they had that, but none of Liberty County had any electricity at that time in the rural area. So they let a contract out to a contractor to build all of Liberty County, and a big part of it, Long County. And that contractor was Chambliss and White. Now, Mr. Chambliss, after he finished the contract at Canoochee and Liberty and Long County, and he went on to become general manager up at Alamo, at the co-op at Alamo. And I don't know Mr. White, I never did know too much about him. But in 1950, I came out one day and said, we finished. We got all the projects that have been surveyed out, and all that we have to build, we finished. So now we won't be needing any of you anymore. And at that time, they had about probably 60 to 75 heads was working there between the different line crews and the right-of-way crews and the pole-setting crews and all. It was about probably 60 to 75 heads. And so they fired all of us. They kept four people. And they kept Jim Floyd, Tennyson Elders, Billy Ritchie, who they had been three of the foremen of the job. And the rest of us, well, they had one other fellow there that the name of Leroy Lynn, and they wanted to keep him. For what reason, I don't know, but anyway, that was not my decision to make, so all I had to do was just accept the fact that I didn't have a job. But anyway, about 3 months later, they called me and wanted to know if I wanted to go back to work. I said, no, you didn't fire me now. I think I'll stay for a while. I might find something better. But I did, and then he called me again later on, and by that time I had accumulated quite a bit of debt, so I said, I better go back to work doing something. And I'd also accumulated a wife during that time, so I had to go back to work. And
I was going to ask you, when you started on the line crew, y'all didn't have a machine to put the pole in and stand the pole up, did you? Or did you?
We'd have had nothing hydraulic. Nobody heard of hydraulics at that time.
Right.
We had an A-frame. You had to set that frame up. It was three pipes, you know, that you set up on the back of your truck. And it was a winch up in the back, and that's all the equipment they could have she had at that time. They had three ton and a half stake body trucks. They had one old wore out line truck, and they had one pickup truck and with a service body on it. But now that service body, the old truck had been turned over and wrecked so many times. Tennyson Elders was at one time he was about the only employee they had there, and he had a habit of getting a little bit too much corn liquor around about the places he'd come in. One day he was coming in and he was kind of flying low in that old little old truck, and that thing left the road and it passed across the ditch, went out and hit two or three trees and it warped it all up. And but it didn't kill him. And so they wouldn't trade the truck, they kept it. And it's a truck that we called Old Rag. And if you ever got, they needed you to do something and you had to drive Old Rag, but that thing, it run dog-legged all the time and just all the time. And you drive that thing all day, it'd about run you crazy. But anyway, that's the truck that I was allowed to drive most of the time with old Rag. But Mr. Ritchie was a unique individual, and they have contended with to try to measure the worth of a man for a long time at Canucci, and some of rather primitive methods. But his way of measuring the worth of a man, he would ride out on the job, and he had a little green Ford pickup truck, and he would ease down the road. And if he drove up where the crew was working, he'd stop off at a distance, and he'd look and he'd observe. Well, if he seen somebody standing around with their hands in their pocket or not doing anything, that afternoon, whenever you went into the office and your paper, your money was being waiting on you. And they didn't pay by check then. We were all temporary, and they paid cash, you know. So your little envelope with your pay in it, if you had made up that time, would be waiting on you when you got in. And we had one fellow there, he was a real goofball. And he wouldn't do anything, he wanted to drive a truck all the time. He wanted to drive a truck all the time. And he wouldn't do it, he's supposed to be digging holes. But he just didn't like to work. And one day we were working out on Lintown Road, and I was digging on a hole, and he'd been sitting there watching me for an hour and a half, hadn't offered to do a thing. And I looked down the road, and I seen a dust coming down the road, and I seen that little green truck come around the curve. And about the time I seen it, this other fella, Oscar Oliver, he seen it coming too. And he jumped up, and he said, "Let me rest you some." I said, "Man, you've been sitting all this morning, you haven't rested me." I said, you know, "I'm not going to let you have these diggers now." He said, "Oh, let me hold them diggers." I said, "Oscar, you try to take your digger from me?" I said, "Me and you going to go, you might even go in that hole." And I said, "No, I see that green truck coming down the road. You don't think you're going to get my diggers?" He was a quick thinker, though. He run and he pulled up the hood of the truck. And Mr. Richard drove on up. He said, "Well, how's it going with you fellas today?" I said, "Going fine with me," and I kept on digging. I didn't stop. "I just going fine with me, Mr. Richie." And he said, "Oscar, what you doing?" Oscar said, "This old truck's been skipping all the morning, and I'm trying to adjust the carburetor on it."
He got away with it.
He got away with it, yeah. But he was a nice fella. He did me a lot of favors. And I want to, there's a lot of things I'd like to tell, but I mean, we won't have time for all this. But now, I want to emphasize one thing. Now, there were about 10 or 12 of us working at that time. And we had a wreck. McKinley was in the wreck. It didn't hurt him bad, but we had one fellow work with us in the name of Roy Bazemore. And Roy was a real nice fellow. But anyway, I had a wreck, and it was not job related, and it broke Roy's leg and some other bones in him, I've forgotten now. And Jim Floyd, it broke his arm and broke his nose and skinned him, all that. And anyway, they brought him to the hospital, and Dr. Jeltz had a hospital in Regal at that time, and brought him in there. I was not with him, but they brought him in there, and then Dr. Jeltz said, no, says, "I'm not going to see." Said Floyd, said, "Yeah, I'll see him." Said he got the money to pay his bill, but said, "These Bazemores, I done lost enough money on them. Said, don't take him, get him out of here. I don't even want him in here." So it took a day before we ever found a doctor that would see Roy. And next day, we carried him two or three different places before we ever found him. And then we had a fella got hurt on the job, and we couldn't. Some of us had to stand good for his bill at the hospital. So we were not making much money. It was a poor paying job. And so we said, we want some insurance. And the board of directors at that time, they said, they turned us down. They said, no, we don't do it. Anyway, so we decided, we just stay off of work. We'll quit. We'll just strike. And so we agreed that we'd all strike next week. Nobody show up for work Monday morning. And And we all held to that except two. Two of them did give in and come back to work. And well, they had a bad time later. But anyway, the rest of us held out. And at the end of the week, they said, no, we're not giving anything. They had a special board meeting and said, no, we're not giving you anything. And the president of the board, Mr. D.L. Durrance at that time, he had been to Alder Mahal EMC, and the manager up there, George Strader, what we all called him, Andy Gump, but he told me about it later that he came up there and wanted to borrow some men for a few days so they could get some. And he went to, he didn't get in at Alder Mahal. And then he went to Metter, and Cleo Miles was the manager there. And I learned about that later through one of the employees that worked there, Curtis Cook. And they had been up there and wanted to borrow some help up there too for a few days and look if you get somebody and put them on the job. Anyway, they didn't have any extra help. They wouldn't let them have anything. So they came back and they had another meeting. And they decided that they would give us a raise. They'd give us 5 cents an hour raise, but they would buy us hospitalization insurance and also a retirement plan. Most of the employees said, no, we're not going back at that. But I said, well, that hospitalization insurance is worth a whole lot, and the retirement plan can be worth a lot. So anyway, we all decided we would come back to work. And so I'm, Canutia has the excellent benefits today, but that's how it was originate, how it begun. And I don't know when they would have ever got around offering hospitalization or retirement if that had not happened.
Thank you.
Because now they did not have the interest of the employee. And
we all thank you for that.
Well, that's how you got, and I feel very strongly about this insurance. I mean, and some of the rest of it too. Because we know. I don't know how many months it took me to make up that 1 week that I missed for work, but 5 cents an hour didn't do it anytime soon, you know. And but that's how the first retirement plan come to Canutia and retirement benefit. And then after Mr. Ritchie died in 1963, he was come down with leukemia and Hodgkin's disease, and it didn't last long. But then they hired Walter McCart. Walter McCart was a good man, and he was a good manager. And when he came to Canutia, he said one of the first things he's going to have to do, we're going to have to overhaul the wage and salary plan here. And we're going to have to overhaul this insurance plan too. And the retirement plan. And what's it did take him now? This was in 1963. We were under a plan, it was called a New England plan. Mr. Kibler out of Savannah sold that plan. It was very cheap. It didn't pay much, but anyway, it satisfied us. It did have something. And so it took him to 1969 to come under the NRECA retirement program. And that was a real boomer when we got that. I mean, that was good. That was the best. We never dreamed we'd get anything that good, you know. And Mr. McCart was a real good manager. And he was responsible for me getting an awful lot of breaks. I was promoted a number of times under his administration. And he was responsible for me being in. At one time I was an acting office manager. So some people asked me what I did. I said, well, I've done everything. To go for holes, to climb poles, and I even fell off one or two. But anyway, I was a janitor. I was an assistant manager temporary on a basis. I did wind up as a manager of maintenance and operations, and I was in charge of all the outside operation at one time after under Mr. McCart, after Jim Ford left, we split it. So. He had had part of it before then, and I'd had part of it. So after he retired, then he put me in charge of all of it. And, it was really too much. It was too much on one person. And that got the best of me. But I enjoyed it, and I worked with some good people. And when he said he was going to make a video of this, I said, well, they finally give me an opportunity to tell all about them, all I wanted to about them bad boss man I had. But I won't do that. Oh, I worked under some very good people. They were all unique in their method of operation. Now, it took a while to get used to some of them, you know, but they were unique, and they had all of them had different strengths in different areas, different fields. And so I enjoyed my work at Kanuki.
I know you can go on a long time. We have some other people. That
I know. I'm noted for this running too long.
No. I've enjoyed it. Thank you very much.